Well, I suppose I could ask you one question as everybody thinks about their questions, which is, how do you relate your own papers to each other's papers? That is, I was sort of trying to find connecting threads through performativity and through issues of sort of how one works with local actors. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts listening to each other.
Well, I wrote some strange things down. I wrote, for example, that I think we need to remember that actually a lot of collecting still goes on in places around the world. I'm not speaking now of the kind of above board, in quotes, above board collecting of large corporate museums, but I'm thinking more of people who are going and buying the final photographic archives in various parts of Latin America or in Africa, for example. So there is a strategy of acquisition that goes on, especially to do with the archives of people who are just about to die, who were part of performative situations where there maybe the material doesn't exist, it's disappeared. And the difficulty for artists who have been involved in those kinds of situationist moments to create a communicational abstinence, to say no. To say, no, I don't want to sell our archive, our slides from 1970s, so that you have more information about this and so that we can belong to a focus on performance and actionism in the 70s and show that this has a global ramification. I don't want to share it with you. I think that notion of communicational abstinence is something that certain artists have tried to do since the mid-90s and have suffered as a result. Yeah, so if you look at which artists have been collected, you also know that there has also been an attempt to politicize the collecting desire on the part of certain people. The other thing which I thought was particularly interesting listening to Zdenka was the idea that you could reduce your floorage space. You know, we always want these large spaces. One of the most interesting exhibitions I've seen recently was here in the Hamburger Bahnhof, and the curator is sitting here in the front row, and it was to do with music, and it was amazing to have performance taking place inside the exhibition space with all the problems that it could raise. It was great to have these rooms used differently. So I think that the question of large exhibition space, it's uninteresting. I think that there's every reason for the public to begin to usurp the museum as a location which you can actually access. Not always, because sometimes you have to pay a lot of money to get in. I mean, some exhibitions, one in Basel was 23 Franken. It's like, whoa, yeah, you don't go into it. But if you can find certain national museums which are free, then you can begin to usurp them as spaces of education which are no longer accessible, say, for a large majority of the population in terms of universities. Things can go on in museums that are no longer possible elsewhere.
Well, with regard to your question, as I was listening to Zdenka, I was thinking that on the surface, because of the choice of terminology we use, it may seem like we're talking from opposite ends, when in fact I think there is a lot in common between the project that Zdenka has in Ljubljana and the project I work in Peru, because even though I stress the term local, and Zdenka is talking about an international utopia, in the end, I think, in terms of both size, resources, location in terms of the relation to centers, and all sorts of other issues, I think there's a lot in common in spite of the evident differences. So that's one thing I thought about as we were discussing.
I think in relation to that, one thing I thought really tied your papers very much together was each of these museums is engaged in a perpetual renegotiation of history, in which one thing which seemed like a natural practice at a previous time becomes increasingly unnatural and needs to be recycled into the present and reconsidered, and then one sort of gets stuck in different moments of recycling. And then there's a new process of recycling.
For me, the interesting question is why the contemporary is so much of different recycling, revisiting, and you know. So I was talking also about it, repetitions. Sustainable museum is actually about, you know, coming always back to the seemingly same thing, but we know that repetition is never the same from Deleuze and so on. And I think that actually today's moment, the contemporary moment, the global world we are, needs this different threes, because it's the moment when we are unable to think a real alternative. I think we are still unable to do it. I mentioned Margaret Thatcher, and there is no alternative, and I was talking about the utopia, but my understanding of the utopia is not about dreaming about something, but it's more related to Wallerstein's utopistic about, you know, the potentials that are already there and then we need to use. So in these terms, I am very near to the idea of museum as a research center, museum as a school, and university, as Deleuze and Patrick were saying, and also Natalia's museum actually is about it. So it is about, you know, going back to your collection to research, to reinterpret, to revisit different histories. So it is still a moment that we are living it about this retrograde view. So we are probably still unable to look forward in the full capacities.
I think one thing I'm also quite interested in, because I'm much more of a historian, I deal with contemporary work, but very much in the context of the 19th century. And I think one of the things that I notice as I switch from one sort of institutional environment, here it's contemporary art, and then more university historians, art historians, and so on, is that the ways in which the disciplines constitutes the boundaries of their research and what is allowed and what type of discourse is allowed is so radically different. And so I'm rather fascinated by the ways in which artists think about the relationship with history very differently from the ways in which curators think about the relationships with history, from the ways in which art historians think about the boundaries of what you can talk about in relation to history and how discourse is constructed. So I sort of find myself moving between these different arenas, and people are talking about history, but they're talking about history as a very different thing. And I think that was also very fascinating in your talks, because each of your institutions is grappling with this, or with the Ethnographic Museum is not grappling with it, but probably should be.
But I don't know. When I studied contemporary art as an artist, at the late 70s, there was only one thing you could study, because it was the only thing that the artists who at that time made sense to me, whether it was Lothar Baumgarten or Joseph Kossuth or Susan Hiller, it was anthropology. There was nobody in their right mind in Vienna, where I was at the time, would have studied art history. What would you have done with a Cinquecento when you were looking at Stuart Brisley rolling around in coal, or Gina Pane slicing herself? And the same with philosophy. So I think we have to keep in mind that the relationship between the academic discourse and the museum, it changes and it shifts. And what interests me at the moment is where the location of new inquiry might be connected to the collections that would fuel those students that are now global, that are doing curatorial studies, cultural studies, trans studies, black studies, post-colonial studies, come on, the list is really endless, that are all versions, for good reason, of a different kind of disciplinary empowerment that have roots back to sociology, to linguistics, to psychoanalysis, to anthropology, to philosophy. And for me, it's not clear where the students who are doing this in South Africa, in Nigeria, in Senegal, in Latin America, where they're going to work. So the notion of a museum university, the re-implementation and remediation for the purpose of serious politicized and poetical inquiry, it can't be anything other than these millions of objects that constitute the world's art histories. And it's not possible that one discipline controls and legitimizes the administrative, the legal, and the discursive and epistemological understanding of this material. And so I question the use of the museum as a university, also in order to move away from the idea that if you've studied post-colonial cultural studies, curatorial studies, then all you're going to want to do is to become the director of a museum of contemporary art. And there's something there which I haven't quite managed to resolve myself. But the issue between academia and the museum needs to be radically rethought.
I completely agree with that, because in a certain way, the objects in the museum, they're made to be silent and they're left to what they look like. And there are actually a lot of intellectual history that's behind them, histories of thought. And behind those histories of thought, there are different spaces of realities which may not correspond with our notions of reality or our notions of materiality and so on. And the more one thinks about those intellectual histories, the more that artists and the idea of integrating other cultures into our own cultural productions get to respond not simply to the physical form of things, but to the ideas that have informed those forms and in the ways in which those things have been perceived. So there's, to me, a problem with including everything in the world as objects without also thinking about what are the ways in which those objects have been thought in the world, in the pasts in which they have moved through. And of course, that's a very complicated question, because something that's made in, I don't know, the 5th century has a different being in the 10th century, has a different being in the 15th century. It maybe is gone for 1,000 years in between. And each of those beings is a different mind state. And to me, that's a very fascinating relationship with history that often isn't taken up through things like art history, which tends to be focused on histories of origins and sort of locative linear histories.
I would just like to add that, you know, we are not discussing enough the question of the subject, who is the subject of reactivization of the history. You know, we are talking who is missing in certain histories, who is excluded, who is included. I think these are not really relevant questions. The relevant question is who is using the history, who is reactivating it. That's why I think that this model of sustainable museum is so important, you know, because it brings the question of the subject back also, the agent of the history, the material condition. So of course there is knowledge everywhere, but you know, not everywhere we have the same conditions to reactivate the knowledge. So the knowledge can be still accumulate in the dominant centers of epistemology and museums.
I think that's very true, and I actually, one of the things that has motivated my professional career is trying to preserve a group of objects that would otherwise be lost to any sort of public sphere, or would be lost to a certain specific community to which those objects are directly linked. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about the global museum and we talk about the production of knowledge, I truly believe that in the work with objects, in curatorial work, there is a type of construction of knowledge that is very necessary for the production of art history and other disciplines, other related and unrelated disciplines, and that the university has been traditionally very far removed from that kind of knowledge. So that is an issue. And the other issue that I also find in terms of the issue you just brought up is precisely who gets to buy the world. You know, we have been seeing a lot of, for example, in the case of Latin America, Latin American collectors actively supporting and being very generous with European and North American institutions. And when you turn back and you look at what's locally being constituted, you see that it's nowhere near what is being acquired elsewhere. So you end up having a very unbalanced distribution of how of objects. I mean, these objects are moving to central collections, and it's not just one museum acquiring, it's not two museums, it's not three museums. It's hundreds of museums that are actively acquiring works globally. And that I wonder sometimes, it seems to me that there's something very similar to what was happening at the time of colonialism.
Yes.
In, you know, late 19th and early 20th centuries. It's not so different, it just works differently. It operates through different circuits and in different ways. But I think that in the end, there's something very similar happening.
Because the idea that you could still find life's unknowns, it cannot be done through the colonial discipline of museum anthropology and collecting any longer. There's a kind of no way, guys, you don't buy anymore. Shh. Only certain museums, like the Musée du Quai Branly, has a budget of $2 million a year, and they only buy works that relate directly to the tree and the provenance of a particular masterpiece that they happen to have. So where do you find the risk that made the anthropologists and the collectors buy the spermy, saliva, hair-ridden nail and tooth objects from the past? The only risk that's left is this risk of global purchase on life's unknowns through contemporary art.
I think there's...
But there's also... I mean, I agree with you, but there's also a contemporary heritage that is being lost. I mean, there's a 1960s, 1970s, 1980s that is also being dispersed and lost to certain communities. So, again, there are places where there will be art and there are places where there probably will be very little of it.
But I think that also has to do not only with the global museum, but also with the globalization of the idea of the museum. Because there are many places which don't try to have a globalized museums with increasingly diverse collections. That tends to be something which Europe and America are more interested in. And the other question that comes to mind is, who are museums for? That is, even at the Museumsinsel in Berlin, when you ask, okay, who's coming to these collections, 90% of the collections, I don't know if this is true, I don't think this is true here, but they're not for locals, they're for tourists. And the Humboldt Forum is a performance for tourists. And so what are you doing when you have local communities? I'm going to speak about Turkey, where the people who are wealthy enough to travel, the first thing they'll do when they go abroad is they'll go to a museum. But at home, they're... museums aren't very popular things unless you're going to the restaurant. And so there's a very small elite, even among the elite, who even go to museums. Museums aren't part of a general sense of being cultured in many places. You know, local people don't often go to museums, and I think that's true here also. Of course, that has a lot to do with what you were mentioning in terms of entrance fees in many places. So England dealt with this by having very low entrance fees, so people go to the museum because it's warm. And it's a way of getting people in. But I think that one of the things is that we're not only dealing with exclusions of the other, but also class, education, things like that, and really, who is the museum for? What is it collecting for in these dynamics between elites?
I think this is the crucial, you mentioned one thing which I think is crucial, and this is that the, you know, the globalization is not only about bringing the artifacts and ideas to one center, and it's not only about marketing the things, but it's also about changing the very idea of the museum. So the model of the museum is now, you know, it, of course it's Western model, but it has changed due to the globalization. I remember when we prepared the Simon conference exactly in Istanbul, so I was a president at that time, and I proposed to the board to invite people from the region who are not necessarily from the museum, because there were not many museums in some spaces where we would like to have people from. So the question was whether to ignore that spaces then, if there are not museum, or to find the people who are somehow involved in the heritage. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so I recognize and I learned from this process that, you know, the notion of the museum really changed, and it has to be rethought. So again, rethought. So it's not only about a institution with the poles, with the collections, but it is about the heritage. So how to think the heritage today? What is the heritage, and who has the rights to have to take care about the heritage? In Eastern Europe, we know a lot of artists from the, you know, the socialist period, but also from today, who I called, I use the term self-historicization in terms of their work, because they created archives because there were not no museum institutional work that would be good enough, or institutions were not interested in non-official art or whatever. So there are around the world many initiatives that are absolutely crucial for the museums today, and for the heritage, and for the history, because you can't find some things in the existing institutions. So there are individuals, there are NGOs, there are different initiatives that are hardly be called museum, but we have to think them as in terms of the what museum normally do.
I think we I've seen a few people who hopefully looked like they were going to ask questions.
Okay, so there's one over here and then one over there that raised the hand earlier, and then everybody else.
Hello, my name is Christoph Bazar. My question goes to Dr. Clémentine Delis. A couple of years ago at another conference at the Humboldt Lab, you were already talking about the museum as a laboratory, as an agent of cultural production. And you had quoted Luke Willis Thompson, the artist from New Zealand, with who you had worked at that time. Who said that if we put the museum in reverse mode, that means if we take everything out of the museum that once came into the museum, it would take us 150 years. So that kept bothering me for a couple of years now, and I was wondering how... did you come up with this number, 150 years? How did you calculate that in the first place? And could you please talk a little bit about why restitution is a, at least that's what I understood, is in your opinion a key factor for reinventing the museum, reshaping the museum into a laboratory, into university maybe, into an agent of cultural production?
So just to thank you. I'm sorry if I keep repeating myself at every session. Luke Willis Thompson came to the museum as an artist in resident. He's half Fijian, half New Zealander. And like all the artists, he had the option of selecting pretty much what he wanted from the stores that were brought into a space that was part of a domestic research cycle. So he lived in the same villa and he had studio spaces to work within. He had access to the library, he could borrow whatever he wanted, he could speak to the custodians as long as he wanted, and he had a selection of objects that were placed in the lab. The lab was not public, the lab was not the exhibition, and it wasn't the depot. So he could go 24 hours, and this access issue is really important, and look at these objects whenever he wanted. And one of them was a mask from New Britain, made out of a skull, the half of a skull, and then embellished with a stick that runs across the jaw. and the wearer of this mask places it, bites into the mask with a stick in their mouth, and that way holds the skull of the other of the dead person against their own face. And after 3 weeks, Luke came to see him and he said, I know what I want to do. I know what I want to do. I want to give the materials budget that you've given me to somebody who's just lost a loved person, a member of their family or a loved person, to repatriate the body from Frankfurt to wherever they come from, ideally from a location that is reflected in the collections of the museum. So maybe not from Slovenia, but maybe from Egypt or from further afield. And this put the museum into a particularly interesting position that it hadn't had to have before. You know, the politics from the other side is to say, you're the multicultural museum, you're the world cultures, you should attract people, right? But in this case, what we had to do was to establish ethical, political, aesthetic, social practices that are, in Saskia Sassen's word, under the radar, that are not coming anywhere close to the central cultural institutions in a city like Frankfurt. Because Frankfurt being this promotion of internationalism, it doesn't just bring living people, it also deals with the death of a large amount of people in Frankfurt. And the problem then of the fact that you cannot simply be buried in German soil, right? So there is a practice that operates to restitute people back to wherever they come from. And with Yvette Mutumba, Luke Willis Thompson went and tried to find the interlocutor, to find the agent. And eventually they found a former imam, Mustafa Shaheen, and after long negotiations and him pretty much bifurcating the project in terms of the documentation, they handed over a couple of thousand euros to this man to do what he wanted to do, to hand over to a family. And Mustafa Shaheen provided photographic documentation of his dead son who hadn't been, who one couldn't repatriate because he'd been born in Germany. Now this question threw up a whole, I mean, in the exhibition and in the subsequent discussions with the public, it threw up really productive debates around the issue of restitution. To say this is not just a question of relic diplomacy, which I would support, it's necessary, but it's also about looking at where the problem of repatriation actually takes place today. Now, I'm no longer a museum director, but having understood that the 15 museums in Germany contain, in quotes, big quotes, duplicates of one another's collections, and that in 1962 or 3, Frankfurt anthropologists went to the Sepik River and in the spirit of salvage anthropology, removed 4,000 objects in a style of serial kleptomania, in other words, not just one bridal headdress from the Sepik, but 20, then in order to swap with other museums, then frankly, I'd have no problem. I'm not sure how one would qualify it, but I'd have no problem in attempting a restitution of, say, 20% of the collection. If it comes back straight away onto the Belgian tribal art market or in Paris in an auction house, then we can discuss the evaluation politics of this particular object. Yeah? On what grounds should this object from the CPIC be qualified as $300,000 worth? Maybe it's worth much more. Maybe the source community from the CPIC says, hold on a minute, this is worth 58 million. Or this is worth 200 million. So the debates start to flare up. And in that context, I think that the issue of restitution has to be looked at you can't say experimental because you're touching on the emotional heritage of a lot of people and the political heritage. But within Germany, we're not talking about being in Vancouver or in Peru, where you don't, the question of the source community is not at hand, then I think that before the politics of restitution ever get far enough, there has to be total access to the objects that are contained in the storage units in these museums. And then we can begin to discuss further. But we're wasting a lot of time talking about restitution, and we're not talking enough about the issue of occupying these collections.
I think I'm just going to add one word to that, which makes it more complicated, which is antiquities. And I'm not going to continue with that thought. Yes, and I think there's a question here, and then there's a gentleman over here.
Thank you very much. And I'd just like to say that this question was originally meant to be posed to the previous panel, but I think the current panel is much more qualified to answer it. My name is Roxley Foley. I'm a descendant of the Gumbungineer of the country and colony now known as Australia. I've been travelling the UK and Europe in talks with institutions about sacred artefact and human remains repatriation. Here in Germany, I visited the Berlin Ethnographical Museum, where I might add we actually found a series of artefacts stolen from the front shores of Botany Bay by Captain Cook and Joseph Banks. It came to my attention in those visits that the museum is about to move to a much more new prestigious location. So my question is, do the panel believe the institutions need to make a lot more effort to appropriately engage with the communities whose stories, works, and histories are represented in their institutions? Especially as in the case of in my country, where my people are facing a physical and cultural genocide, to have the courage to challenge convenient political norms and be representative of not just fetishizing the artworks themselves. Can we challenge the narrative of what belongs in museums and what deserves its rightful place amongst modern art galleries in a position of equality of interpretation of human experience and not just represented as a dead culture? And what can we do to empower a disempowered people to reclaim their right to cultural self-determination when we're at very real risk of becoming a misrepresented historical footnote that will only ever be told by a Western perspective?
Perhaps I will only say that I think most of us here would agree that there needs to be much more active engagement with different communities who lay claims to a particular culture. But at the same time, and perhaps it might seem contradictory with what I just said earlier, I do think that we have to go beyond also the idea of property. And I think we also have to go beyond the idea of rightful interpretation and true interpretations. And I think that we need to find ways of having a greater access generally. I cannot speak for the German museums that hold the objects that you're discussing, but I tend to see the possibility of museums being more open places for debate and discussion. And I've always felt that knowledge is dialogic and you need to be able to discuss among different groups regarding different objects. So I do have issues sometimes with notions of, oftentimes of notions of true interpretation and property, which I think are very complex in any context. But I think perhaps Clementine has more to say about what
you
just
said. I just wanted to say one thing, and thank you for the question. I think that objects are always symbolic, and we treat them as metonyms of culture, and that the museums are also metonyms of authority and the voice of authority. And one of the problems is that we have layers of conflicting history, and the best case scenario would be that these violences had never occurred. That would be the nicest world we could possibly imagine living in. And the problem is that these violences have happened and they've become extremely layered. And that undoing the museum, one can return the object, but one can never undo the violence. And your question made me think about the layers of violence that are embedded in the issue of Palestine and Israel. That is, it would be nice if all those layers of violence, including the parts that aren't in that land, including the ones that are here, didn't happen. But they did. And this creates multiple layers of rights. So the question for me in relation to your question is, how can one make that object become the most articulate of the histories which it symbolizes? And so one question I would have in relation to the idea of the restitution of the object is that if it's an object that the ownership of it in itself is symbolic, then that restitution makes sense to me. But if that object has the opportunity or is given the opportunity to present the narrative of the other in the space where it's distant, then that object may be able to do more symbolic work for the memory of people and violence when it's not restituted. That is, when the authority that's given to those who are speaking becomes diversified. And for me, sort of aside from just thinking about the property rights that are invested in objects, it's very important to also think about the ways in which multiple rights to an object have been construed. And this is why I mentioned the issue of antiquities as well as the anthropological objects, because of course, and this is much more what I work on, so. But these antiquities also came from places, they're embedded in histories of rights to different parts of the world, and so they're not different issues. There was an object that was part of the Lycian treasure. It was the Metropolitan Museum. With great fanfare, it went back to Turkey. And eventually, it long history, but governments changed and the object was sold on the black market and a replacement was put in its place. That object could have theoretically, in the Metropolitan Museum, done a lot more work to talk about how an object like that gets in the Metropolitan Museum, on who are the peoples who could own that. What does it mean that ownership becomes layered over time? What kinds of violences are embedded in the objects as we see them in museums? So I think that restitution almost dangerously can become a way of forgetting these violences and absolving their multiple layers of what's happened in the past, because then you stop talking about it because you've given the object back. It's done. And I don't know if those violences get erased that way. So it's a sort of a question I have that I think comes up with restitution.
I just wanted to say that this is what I've been trying to talk about in many ways, and that is that if you think about the new buildings, museum buildings that are being created, there's very, very little discussion at the moment about a kind of the verve and the ingenuity that might go into the building of storage spaces. Storage spaces sound incredibly banal, but the option of constructing an architectonic site for a museum university based on access is for me at the moment extremely exciting. The possibility that many communities, including the source community, would have access to an investigation that would lead to new ideas, that would unearth the extraordinary ingenuity in a huge amount of these objects, that would break down the masterpiece provenance route that you get taken through when you go to these museums and they show you this is the most important object we have in our collection. This kind of understanding of a museum interests me because it says immediately that, hold on a minute, the economic imperative, the consumerist imperative of the museum can be changed. There is nothing to say that we can't be as public as we are now by doing something else within the museum, by creating this notion of a museum university. Nothing is more public than that. But no, we continue to make exhibitions that have a certain time structure, a certain funding apparatus. And I think that's where Josef Beuys was so brilliant. And if you don't mind, given that we're in a global condition, I would like to just read something in German out. And those of you who don't understand German will then be confronted with a different kind of problem. But he said in 1975, and it's kind of specific to here as well, he said, "Das Museum ist tot. Das Museum ist ja nichts anderes als so ein Ding wie hier. Es ist im Grunde nur rein Gebäude. Wie sich Menschen in diesen Mauern verhalten, das hängt eben von den Menschen ab. Denn ich kann doch keine Vorurteile haben gegenüber einem Museum, genauso wenig wie ich ein Vorurteil haben kann gegenüber einer Kirche oder einem Bahnhof. Museen auch sind Organismen, insofern sie sich wandeln. Ich will ja die Museen zu Universitäten machen, die dann praktisch ein Department für Objekte haben. Das Museum könnte auch das erste Modell einer, und er unterstreicht das, permanenten Konferenz für diese kulturellen Fragen werden. Aber die Voraussetzung dafür wäre eine absolute Toleranz gegenüber allen möglichen Initiativen. Das müsste das Museum regelrecht praktizieren. And it's the word praktizieren which becomes interesting there.
Okay, there was one question there and then here. Oh, okay.
My name is Maria Nitulescu, and this is my second intervention today, or second question, in this beautiful conference. So since this morning, I'm assisting here to beautiful ideas and opinions on museum practice, a rebranding of museum, a new rethinking of cultural heritage. But what would be the solution to all this? Don't you think it's important to find a common ground that all these common ideas, well, there are different ideas here, beautiful ones, but as well common ones, should come together and this should form common practice of ethical, moral, and political issues in this world. That's what I think. I think this is important, like just look as well for solutions. Don't you think so?
Well, I mean, I think one problem that one has with institutions is that we're all individual actors. And I work at a university. I have enormous critiques of the university. I've had enormous critiques of every university I've worked at. So one of the problems is that, and I think this is true of museums, is we're within these institutions that have a lot of power, but that power is rarely located in a person who can make change. And so each of us intervenes into the system where none of us have a lot of space of movement and the mechanisms aren't terribly clear. So it would be nice if we could establish an ethic of practice or one could all sort of change it in a way that it should be. And yet with any institution or conglomerate of institutions or I wouldn't even say an institution or a museum is an institution. It's more like a typology, because each one is so different and there's so many vested interests of power and finances and things like that, that inevitably one's in a perpetual negotiation. And so, you know, I going back to your idea of the museum as a university, one of the reasons universities become so stagnant is because they aren't simply educational institutions, they're also diploma granting and therefore qualification giving and therefore institutions where a lot of power and measurement is vested. And you know, one wants it to be that the museum can be an educational institution and the university is an educational institution, but they're also so deeply invested in mechanisms of power and authorization and legitimacy that, you know, how does one mediate that? So I think what I'm hearing from you is a very utopian, idealistic view of it would be nice if this were possible. I don't know how that could be realized through mechanisms and financing as they exist. And the ways in which people move into position where they have more power often is because they compromise and become less radical. And so from outside, it's very easy to critique. From inside, people make choices between entering into power and or staying on the side of critique. And I don't know, there's some people who manage to bring them together, but the moments those really work are very rare in my experience. You might disagree with me. Just
well, I am not a specialist on anthropological museums. But just I want to say something about the perception I have as an outsider. Restitution, as far as I understand, is not the same than reparation. Then I think that restitution doesn't mean that the bad things made in the past will be forget. It's a different thing. Maybe negotiations are a good way of memorialization, not just possession of objects. And on the other side, what I see is that a Latin American museum that is going to the market to buy objects for its collection, and restitution worked in the past with objects, is, as far as I remember, the funerals of Atahualpa were in Chile and were restituted to Peru after the Pacific War. Then it worked. Then I don't know what is the solution, but I think that should be some kind of ways to talk about these topics that are not forbidden. Because in a way, it's like you can talk about that because it's history, is history. Facts in the past are facts in the past. Well, I come from a country where all these issues are discussed every day, and negotiation is a way to discuss. And then I wanted to ask Natalia, how do you feel creating a collection of Peruvian art and going to the market? How is that? And because you brought also to the discussion new ways of colonialism that has to do in a way with internal colonialism. It means a Latin American collector that instead to distributing or donating the works that bought in the market to the countries of Latin America from where these objects are coming from, is donated the works to a key museum like the Museum of Modern Art. Then I think that I don't want to, you know, I don't want to erase the problems. It's not a solution probably we can find here, but the problems are there, and that's...
Well, I think it has to do with the fact that we have to realize that there are very specific conditions, and global economy is not in any way generating the same for every region where it operates, and it's operating very differently in different regions. So, for example, there are companies that make immense donations in their countries of origin, and they will never make such donations in the other countries where they operate. In the same way, they are people from one country donating to another country, but philanthropy does not go in the same direction as globalization. And I think that that's also a very important issue, because we talk about being in a globalized world, and philanthropy has not been globalized in any way. So one makes the efforts one can make within certain very clear limitations. But in the end, you know, deep down, it is an issue of money, it is an issue of power, and of unequal distribution. I am all for international circulation of things, and I think there is a value in that. But again, one has to see where the weight is, and one has to see where the issues are and the problems are. And the truth is that there is a very unequal distribution of all sorts of things, including art, of course.
I think it's interesting to think about this also in the context of the forthcoming exhibition, the Resonance exhibition, which takes as its cue the collection in the collections in Berlin that have different shapes and forms. And what has interested me in particular in the Staatsbibliothek, in the National Library here, is to look for elements which are called, even in German-speaking world, lieu de mémoire, right? So this is an act of inscription into an object. It's a biographical inscription that changes because everybody has a different relationship to what they touch, what they repair, what they stitch together, the way that the kind of the syntax of their use of a collection. And I hope that what we're trying to do with Zdenka and with the curators of the Hamburger Bahnhof is to look at this collection again and to say, but there are other sites of memory that can be now highlighted from a collection that had a very linear or very kind of particular vision of the 20th century. And so in some ways, the argument is that you have everything you need. In some ways, you don't need to collect what you think you need to collect. Somehow, it's already there. It's just that the lieu de mémoire has to be rethought and reconfigured. And also, to come back to the gentleman's comment, that the lieu de mémoire can also be produced by the public. And so my question then is, in what way can we produce an exhibition that isn't adopted like a flat screen, but becomes a site of inscription, rather like the wax that is placed on the cross again and again and again to signify that you were there? Yeah? And in this world where everybody is moving around and for very different reasons, the question of the lieu de mémoire becomes really important.
Just a brief addition to that. I think that there, in response to your question, I think that museums, because they're very much invested in existing power structures, are often very resistant to critical evaluations of their own history. That is, it's rare to see a museum that doesn't present a history that's outside of itself or present its history as a history of the fathers of the museum. It's always fathers. And instead thinks about how it is critically engaged with the politics of its past. There are very few institutions that are willing to question their own power structure in that way. And so that's a huge problematic of the museum, because I think if we're going to think about museums as ways of engaging with the history of politics and how history persists in our contemporary world, we'd have to have museums that were much more open to those kinds of critical evaluations of their own roles in history. And there's a resistance to that, though I think that for the public, that might make it a lot more interesting than the history that's outside of the museum.
Okay, so if there's no resistance from the panel, I would say that these two questions that are here would be the last before we go get the break.
Good afternoon. My name is Christine Kizorsi, and I just want to, I have a question for Clementine Delis. First, I would like to congratulate you on your lecture. That was very refreshing. And I have another question regarding what you just said, the globalization of the museum and what museums should be in the 21st century. I just read recently that Helsinki rejected to have another one of those Guggenheim museums. And would you say that this... because we all know that the Guggenheim, the Solomon Guggenheim Museum, is originally in New York, and they have as a kind of flagship store, and now they reopen in other countries. And I would like just to know what your opinion is. Is this the new kind of globalization of museums?
Well, you'll forgive me if I vulgarize Duchamp for a second, but you remember I spoke in the talk about the objet ambigu of Paul Valéry. Yeah, he finds this thing on the beach and he doesn't know it's been thrown away by the sea and the earth can't retain it. It was written, funnily enough, that piece was written 6 years after Duchamp started producing the ready-made, which was obviously a manufactured, non-ambiguous object. I would like to see a musée ambigu, yeah, again. I don't want to see a ready-made, even if I adore the ready-made and the signification of Duchamp. I want to see a musée ambigu, and I think we've forgotten how much we all enjoy weird museums, the Odilon Redon Museum in Paris or other strange museums, and there's nothing to stop a museum from taking on an ambiguous character. It hasn't got to proclaim its legitimacy the whole time. It hasn't got to tell you that this is the right way to show a collection and this is the best global exhibition that's ever been made. It can show its flaws and it can try and show the it has to enable some kind of new inquiry, whether it's on the part of the artist or on the part of the curator or on the part of a whole bunch of people who haven't even decided what their professions are yet, what their position to art is. And it's that ambiguity which is, for me, incredibly important because it can carry the traces of previous attempts to understand what we're doing with art practice in the way that Louis Kamnitzer spoke about the genie, right? So we want the genie, we don't really care about the lamp half the time, even though we need to understand that these, that there have been lamps produced that come in and out of power like objects in collections that are forgotten and that can be brought back into the light.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank all of you.